clients always get a feel for who's in the room. And so I want to do a quick survey. Raise your hand if you are a distributor or retailer. Okay. Brand manufacturer. Yeah, got one. And I assume the rest are consultants, partners, etc. Fair? Okay. Yeah, answer good. Okay, so as Barry mentioned, I'm here today to talk about a couple of things. One is how Forrester sort of sees the world of the brand manufacturer, the distributor, and the disruption that's taking place. You'll see some similarities between our research and Roland Berger's research, which I think is quite good. So I'm going to try and kind of sidestep some of what he talked about so we're not redundant. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about a small-scale project that we did for Miracle around the manufacturing space. But before I jump in, I think it's important to sort of highlight where we see the world of B2B today. And again, this is at a very high level. You know, I have to remind people that B2B in the U.S. is at least, the e-commerce side, is at least a $1 trillion business. And on a global basis, 3 to 5 times that. So we're talking just the digital component of B2B is arguably on a global basis $3 to $5 trillion. And it is multiple categories, several verticals, lots of value-added distributors and resellers and wholesalers. So there are a lot of constituent parts here. And so when I talk about B2B, keep in mind that you need to apply this to your circumstance, because what might make sense over here may not necessarily make sense over here in your particular category. The other thing is, at the end, we're gonna leave about 15 minutes for questions. And that, to me, is the most interesting part. So as we're going through, think through your questions, write them down, and then we'll have a mic runner around who will take your questions. So a little context setting. I always like to talk about this because I think it illustrates the complexity and also the opportunity associated with B2B e-commerce. This is a company called DryEase. Anybody heard of DryEase by chance? Okay, good. So DryEase is about a $75 to $80 million US dollar business located in Seattle, Washington. And they manufacture, as the image shows here, industrial dehumidifiers. So these are devices that are bought, you know, en masse by companies that will remove flooding and water damage in a building. So you wouldn't really use one of these at your home. They have smaller versions of these for that. These are used in an industrial capacity. So traditionally, this is what the world looked like for DryEase. You know, I broke it down into three constituent parts here. You got the person who makes it, the person who distributes it, and ultimately the buyer. Now what's interesting here is up until about 7 or 8 years ago or so, this is what their world looked like. They made this, they didn't sell it, they didn't even service it, they just manufactured it, and then they relied on the channel. And at that time it was largely an offline only channel, through distributors, wholesalers, resellers, etc. And ultimately a company like a Service Master would buy dozens, hundreds, thousands of these. But their interaction between DryEase and Service Master was extremely limited. In fact, in the work that I do, I talk to manufacturers frequently, and many of them will tell me they have actually no idea how their product is used, which is boggling to me. But they really don't know. And what they tell me is that we defer to our channel, and our channel, you know, sells, services, owns the customer relationship. And then I say, well, what do you do with customers that want to come directly to you and make a purchase? You must have inbound leads. You must have people come to your website. And what they tell me is, well, we just direct all that traffic to the distribution channel. And then I say, well, how do you know that the distribution channel is going to honor that lead and actually sell through your product versus switching them into some other product, potentially even a private label version? And then at that point, it seems like it's too much for them and their head explodes. But this is the new reality. I mean, like it or not, if you're a brand manufacturer, you have traffic coming to your website, and I'm about to show you some research that says, not only is there traffic coming to your website, but that traffic actually wants to buy from you and is even willing to pay a slight premium for the privilege of doing so. So for those of you who are distributors in the audience thinking this isn't relevant to me, it is relevant to you. Because that used to be 100% your sales arena, and it isn't anymore. So we're in the midst of a transition. I would agree with what Roland Berger said and others, that we're in the exploration phase for marketplaces. We are no longer in the exploration phase for customer interest in the internet, though. And I say that facetiously because every B2C consumer, every B2B buyer, I should say, is also a B2C consumer. And so even though you, as a seller, may not be ready from an infrastructure perspective, a staffing perspective, an organizational perspective, your customers are ready to buy from you. You just may not be ready to sell to them. But the problem with that is that your customers aren't going to wait for you to get ready to sell to them. And I think Amazon is one example of a company that has moved in, stolen away that share, literally around that very notion. They did it in devastating fashion to the retail industry in the United States. And I believe they're going to be doing something very similar in B2B. And we can have a conversation about Amazon at the end or later. That could be its own presentation. But the reality is, there is urgency here. And I do believe that marketplaces, for example, are an opportunity to potentially get ahead of the game a little bit, especially vis-a-vis your direct competitors. In fact, I saw a friend of mine in the audience earlier, and he was saying, we're moving forward on a marketplace. And I said, that's great, why now? And they said, we think there's an opportunity to actually be have the first mover advantage. And I think Roland Berger mentioned this too. I don't think there are going to be multiple first movers here in a particular vertical. It isn't necessarily a winner-take-all, but it's a winner-take-most environment. And so there could be disproportionate gains associated with those who get in early, as opposed to being, I think what a lot of companies like to do, which is be a fast follower and wait. Waiting on something like a marketplace is extremely dangerous because marketplaces are predicated on the notion of critical mass and traffic. And those who build them first will be able to capture that traffic and drive more traffic. Those who build them second, third, or fifth will be fighting for the scraps of traffic. So, we don't always advise our clients to be first movers on certain things. Certain types of technology, we say, take your time, wait, see what happens in the space. For a marketplace, though, if you're seriously interested in it and you see an opportunity, if anything, and I'm not being paid to say this by miracle, if anything, if you're going to do it sooner rather than later. Okay, so back to my illustration. So this is what it used to be for a company like Dryden's. So the last couple of years, things have changed. Some of them organically, so they had nothing to do necessarily with digital. We saw the offline distributors in the middle go online, and we also saw this idea of private label, which is the upper left-hand corner. But what gets really interesting is that middle space. And by the way, this is oversimplified. This is what it now looks like in that middle space for, called the distribution wholesaling layer. Again, just as a reminder, that's what it used to look like just about 7 or 8 years ago. And so now this is what it looks like. So obviously it's impacting everybody. It's a real boon for the buyers. Look at all these options they have now. They're the big winners here. Which is, by the way, exactly what we see on the consumer side of the equation. A shift from the supply side to the demand side. We call it the age of the customer at Forrester, which to me seems like a definition of the obvious, like, you know, the age of gravity or something. But the reality is it has shifted significantly from, you know, suppliers had all the power to now the demand side has all the power. And it has affected every company on the planet. And I think it's just happened first on the consumer side because people are more willing and able and interested in adopting things quickly. It's slower on the B2B side because people take a little more time to think through this. But if you subscribe to what I said earlier, that every B2B buyer is a B2C consumer, then they're ahead of you. they're not waiting for you. And they're going to move on to whatever is the least friction-filled, easiest way to buy. So, to my illustration here, you know, before it was just the online and offline distributors. But now look, there's a consumer channel. Again, sorry, these are some Americanized versions, so you can plug in your European version of this. But there's a company called Sears, which, by the way, is nearly dead from a B2C perspective in the United States. You can actually buy this industrial dehumidifier through Sears, which is the equivalent of buying it through, say, Tesco. You wouldn't think of buying a $1,500 industrial dehumidifier through Tesco. But you can, because Sears uses a marketplace, no pun intended, to do so. So from a customer's perspective, it's completely transparent to them. They go to Sears, they buy it, Sears takes the money, Sears has the customer relationship, but all the fulfillment is done through Zorro, which is a company I'll talk about here in a moment. Again, a very intelligent way to do it. Sears is getting the traffic, Sears has the demand, why not convert that demand into a purchase? As opposed to saying, traditionally, we don't do that, go someplace else, or here's a potential partner in a different experience, they send you in a different direction where the conversion rate goes down. Amazon, again, we could spend days talking about that. Now Amazon is a player, they weren't acquiring this before. You can go to Amazon and buy this industrial dehumidifier, very easy. Again, in the middle, you've got the online and the offline guys. I put in a Dutch company, which I don't know how to pronounce, B-O-E-L-S.
Bulls.
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 They're more like a rental company, in a way, where you can rent these. But for all intents and purposes, it is like a distributor. And then, this is the most interesting part. You've got these online or pure play distributors. And these are literally companies that have no legacy infrastructure. They don't, in many cases, have sales representatives or large investments in sales representatives. And they focus on one thing, the customer experience. And they start from a digitally native perspective. Now you might be thinking, so what, right? It makes a big difference. Because the reason why Amazon has done so well is because they are digitally native as a company. They also happen to be very strong on the supply chain. That's, I think, the deadly combination. 1 and 1 equals 10, because they can do both. These guys have to prove themselves yet on the supply chain side, but they don't have to prove themselves from a customer experience perspective. And ultimately, all of our research shows this, the companies that will win in this new world are the ones that specialize in the customer experience. If you create the right customer experience, customers have no, they don't care how you deliver it, who fulfills it, they just don't care. They go to who they know, they go to the brands they trust, and if it's, they just assume that that company will handle everything. And if you just internalize that, digest that for a moment, that itself threatens to destroy the entire supply chain. So if there are people up front who have all the doors to the building and the only doors to the building, nobody cares what's already in the building. All they care about is how do I get in the front door, and I will choose the door that I like. There are a lot of companies that are not focused on the front-end customer experience, and they're losing, they're hemorrhaging traffic to those who are. So here's the interesting one, though. You see that red line between brand manufacturer and buyer? So I actually asked Dryees, I said, well, in this new world, you know, what are you doing to change how you approach the marketplace? And first of all, at the beginning of the conversation, they told me that everything was just fine. After I talked to them a little bit about this, some of which they didn't even know, which is a little bit frightening, they said, you know, that's interesting. Maybe we should start thinking about selling direct. And I said, well, how are you going to sell direct? And they said, well, we haven't really thought through it. Here's the point. This is what I hear all the time from brand manufacturers. We have an interest in doing this, but we have no understanding of actually how to do it. We don't have the people. We have no history of selling direct. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so even though they may have an ambition or an appetite to do direct selling, they have a bias toward the channel for historical reasons and because of infrastructure. Well, herein lies the advantage of a marketplace. If you're a brand manufacturer, you don't have to build the infrastructure. You can plug something in where the infrastructure is basically pre-built. And by the way, if it doesn't work out for some reason, you haven't made a massive investment, And you can actually, we like to say, it's one throat to choke. You can go to that company and say, you haven't done a good job of A, B, C. So this is a new way for a manufacturer to get their feet on the ground in a market. And in fact, what it is an extension of third-party marketplaces. So actually, let me back up for a moment, because the word marketplace gets overused and it's become genericized. There are different types of marketplaces. Let me just be very clear on the language. When I say third-party marketplace, I'm talking about Amazon. It is a separate site. You give them your SKUs. They own the customer, so to speak. And then they pay you a commission, effectively. Or you pay them a commission, however you want to look at it. A first-party marketplace, which also goes by a direct online marketplace, is a marketplace that a company has on their website. And there are different flavors of that. The one I'm going to talk about specifically is the manufacturer-centric one, which, from my perspective, a first-party marketplace on a manufacturer's website is basically the next generation of what we used to call a dealer locator. I think the days of the dealer locator are over. If when you're on your website, somebody enters a zip code and you tell them which one of your distributors, wholesalers, resellers they can be directed to, that's the old way of doing it. That's the 1990s way of doing it. We know from research, not that we've done, but others have done, the fall off on that is generally about 50%. So you're losing 50% of the traffic that you send through your dealer locator simply because the experience isn't elegant. So why would you do that if you had the option of capturing 100% of the people who were already on your site? Why would you send them in a direction and lose 50% off the top? It doesn't make any sense, but we know why they do it, because it's this deference to the channel, right? Well, again, here's where marketplace could be an interesting solution. So what's driving all this? Well, we did some research last year and found, frankly, some stuff that surprised even me, and all I do is research, so when I get surprised, that's meaningful. 43% of B2B buyers that we surveyed said that they would prefer to buy directly from a brand manufacturer versus a distributor. Now, what does this mean? We didn't say, would you like to buy from a brand manufacturer in the abstract? The answer to that is, well, of course, why not? What's the downside? There's no opportunity cost. We actually said this versus this. And we've done this for 2 years straight now, by the way. It got almost identical numbers. So you start to see a pattern here. What this means for brand manufacturers is that, let's just round up, nearly 50% of your ultimate end users would like to buy from you in some capacity, not all capacities. They don't want to buy everything from you. We'll talk about what it is they want to buy here in a moment. But